he left the hill behind and led the others through the north gate, he couldn't help but feel a chill sweep in his blood. There was something about those posts, something about how they looked. Nappas are suddenly happy. The feeling of eyes. It was undefined and instinctive, but it was weak. Maybe he caught a glimpse of something before the town. Maybe he felt some tiny, almost imperceptible change in his surroundings. Whatever it was, that was our desire to sign. That they would be expecting him now. They went. Directly in front, a wide central street ran straight and clear to the other side of the village, packed with people and lined with tall palms on either side. To their left, a bazaar ran with a blend of noise of merchants, customers, and people. To their right, dozens of Jewish buildings formed from a massive square mile in the distance. After tying their camels up along the street of palms, the fellowship went their separate ways. The wise men headed left toward the bazaar, where Gaspar and Melchior would trade the last of their stolen gold for whatever they would buy, and Balthazar would work on stealing more gold. Joseph, Mary, and the baby went right, toward the cave of the patriarchs, braving a sea of faithful pilgrims to pay their respects to the ancient founder of their kingdom. Joseph held on to Mary for dear life, fearful that she and the baby would be swept away by the current of bodies he had gone. The area hiding their sins and buttoning their hats. Merchants enticing the faithful to buy all manner of souvenirs. There were sacrifices of goats and oxen, grain and wheat. Money changers pouring tombs. Above it all, the people shoving past each other, moving up and down the dirt street that ran through the market center. Above, the man haggling with merchants, the women dragging uncooperative children behind. He could see Gaspar arguing with a man over the price of dried fruits, as Melchior stood fatly and faithfully behind him. An old woman with a club foot limping blindly along. A dog pushing its nose through the dirt, sniffing around for anything that might have... Balthazar locked onto a heavy-set man in sweat-soaked robes. From the quality of his clothing and the size of his belly, he was built to do. And from the outer distance of his head, he was carrying something heavy in his belt. Balthazar guessed it wasn't the same. Balthazar dispatch horsemen to cover all possible exits. Every gate on every side of the city. A small detachment of their soldiers would take position on the streets adjacent to the street of palms, closing in and attacking only if something went wrong. He would let his targets ride into heat, thinking they were days ahead of the pursuers. Think of this. Pilot had watched, his spies scattered among the masts, his men perched on rooftops. He'd watched all those who rode into Hebron from the north, until at last he'd spotted three exhausted camels making their way through the north gate. Three swordsmen, couple, and child on the fence. He'd watched as the Antioch ghost and his companions had split up. The ghost and his fellow thieves to the bazaar, and the couple and the child to the cave. And while this split had been unexpected, it was natural. Pilot dealt with the unexpected. He watched from a second floor window overlooking the street of palms, knowing that he and Fate would soon find each other, one way or another. Joseph had paid his respects, braving the throngs to lay a hand on the monument that covered the living patriarchs. He stopped only long enough to say a quiet prayer for the dead, while Mary waited with the baby nearby. His prayer finished, he'd taken her hand and led her back the way they'd come. All in all, it hadn't been the experience he'd hoped for. The site had been too crowded, the monument too plain. And when he finally worked his way close enough to feel the stone against his palm and send his thoughts to God, Joseph had felt rushed, unable to concentrate. Not because of the noise of his fellow pilgrims or the worries of recent days. It was something else. Even now, as they pushed their way through the crowds, Joseph felt the presence of something sinister outside the walls of his mind. He didn't know why. He and Mary fought the current of bodies until they reached the street of palms, walking south down the center, toward where they'd tied up their camels. They would reach the south gate in plenty of time. And then Joseph knew what it meant. His heart full to bursting. The palm trees that lined the street were bowing their heads, bowing in reverence as they passed. Do they bow for us? Joseph turned to Mary, wondering if she saw it too. But her eyes were fixed squarely on the child. The child, thought Joseph. They bow for the child. Before he could fully grasp what he was seeing, a passage suddenly unveiled itself in his mind. A passage from the scriptures. A prophecy of the coming of the Messiah. The trumpet and the angels shall herald his coming. His name shall be praised from the mountaintops, and the heavens and the earth shall bow before him. It was the prophecy realized. Here was nature bowing before an infant. Here was a vindication of everything he believed, and a total destruction of the armies of doubt.
Stop.
mothers grabbed their children and hurried them away from the path of the Arabs, and fathers met the advancing Roman soldiers with their fists. Balthazar and Melchior were quickly apprehended, and pulled the others up with them. Balthazar kept one hand clenched around a piece of Mary's robes, determined not to lose hold of her. But there was a good chance she had made it for the trial. With the other, he held his sword and readied himself for whatever came his way in front, while Melchior and his saint covered their backs. Gaspar watched his fellow fugitives from a distance, reluctant to join him. He could have easily slipped out of his commotion. He could run away and help him. Poor helpless Melchior, thought of him. No, Gaspar would be able to live with himself if something happened. Besides, there was no honor. Balthazar's soldier threw his middle in joining his fellow fugitives and pressing forward. Balthazar wondered what had taken Gaspar so long. Why he hadn't run with them when the arrows had started flying. But those of fought through the chaos around them. The street of palms, a mess of soldiers, angry men and panicked women. Balthazar and Melchior took the front. Joseph and Gaspar took the rear. Owen and the mayor. The camels! He yelled to the others. Balthazar knew it was their only chance to fight their way to where the camels were tied up and ride off into the desert. He had seen how many Romans there were waiting beyond those walls. He'd seen their horses. Still a long shot. Mary glanced to the side as Balthazar pulled him. She caught a glimpse of a young father, fighting with a Roman soldier, grabbing him to the side of his helmet for a man and trying to bring him to the ground. She saw the young mother.
Never seen it.
still had a very important role to play in this game. Toby had no idea what it was or why he was so absolutely certain. Keep going! Already the sword of the officer proposed. Almost on him now. Strange. Like we're supposed to face each other in uncertainty. Before Balthazar could do any further, the officer was upon him and the two were fighting away. Each knowing somehow that they've been moving toward this moment their entire lives. Two boats on two rivers, winding their way toward the same sea. There was no outlet at all. They simply met in the middle of the panic street, raised their swords, and tried to kill each other. And while the painters were like the memory of the patient when he vanished, with both men striking impressive poses and impressed outfits, the reality was far less attractive. Balthazar and Kyle were both covered in dirt. Sweat and flecks of blood, both doing their best to beat each other's brains, punching and grabbing and pulling each other. While Balthazar was the better sword, Kyle was the better fan of wisdom. And before long, the Antioch Ghost was on his heels, holding the sword out in front of his face, blocking Kyle's repeated strikes. With a sword ready to fight the guy. She was gone. It doesn't make sense. Balthazar thought as he ran for the canvas. How had the Romans known what they were going to do? Why had he felt such a strange kinship with the officer? It didn't matter. What mattered was that no city or village was safe from now on. No road passable. No strangers could be trusted to keep their secret. Not with the Romans looking for it in such numbers. They wouldn't be able to stop. Not until they reached Egypt. But they wouldn't make the Egyptian border without supplies. They had to take a different route, an unexpected route. They wouldn't be able to venture out in public anymore. Not even in disguise. It was too dangerous. What they needed was a place to hide. Resupply. Somewhere unexpected. Somewhere safe. And despite every oath he ever said, Balthazar knew exactly. Chapter 9. The Return. For it was not an enemy then I could have borne it. Neither was it even me that magnified himself against me. Then I would have hid myself from him. But it was I, a man minded, like I, and my friends. Psalms, chapter 55, verses 12 to 13. Balthazar was too tired to tax his mind. Besides, he didn't mind how long. Here they were, and here she was. The sight of six heads of sore eyes. Here was the face they'd all crossed the ocean of sin. Without even no rest. As day became crisp, glaring forth and swooshing. Here was the reason they kept riding half day for the promised land of the ship. The last waypoint of milk for the day of the rest of all night. The last chance to themselves up, and the malnourished dogs roam the streets in circumstance.